sitting 12-1, and so you should be at the bottom of page 887, number 9. It asks you to find F at 3. Well, what does F at 3 really mean? It means that you are trying to find, which you can kind of see the answers, but so there's F at 3, what does that really mean? When we say F of X, it equals Y, correct? But this means F at 3 means I want to know what is the Y value, that's my question, when my X is 3 for the F function. So down here, I have two functions. I got F and G. This is my F of X graph. This is my G of X graph. And you can see it. It's written right there. And it's written right there very small. You with me? So if it says, what is my Y value when I am on 3 on the F function? So I go over 3. 1, 2, 3. And what the ordered pair is 3, comma what? Negative 1. So what does F at 3 really equal? It equals negative 1. Does that make sense? The next one's a little more tricky because it says G inverse of 4. What does that really mean? What does, if I want the inverse of that, what is that actually going to be? What happens when you do the inverse? So instead of looking for the X to be 4 in this one, I'm going to be looking for the when Y equals 4, and I'm going to give them the X value. So when I'm looking for Y equals 4, I'm going to be going up or down. So I go up 4, and I look, where's an ordered pair that hits that? Right here. And the ordered pair is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The ordered pair is 5, comma 4. So the answer to this question is 5. Does everybody understand how I'm doing that? Yes or no? Yes. All right. If they ask you to do positive that, it says F of G of 4. What are you first going to do? You are first going to do G of 4. G of 4 means that I go over on my G function. Go over 1, 2, 3, 4. And what's my output there?
Zero.
What does that mean G of 4 really equals? Zero. So now it's going to be F of 0. When I go on my F function 0, I see that my output is 2. Does everybody understand that? How are we doing? Make sense? Okay. Now, we're going to go over some other ones, but I'm going to go a little quicker so we can get to some other stuff. That's just the inverse, so I'm going to be looking for the inverse when Y is negative 3 on my F function. My X value is then going to be what I'm going to put into my G function, and if you do that, you should get 4. Is everybody good on that? This one, what does it mean if I have F and G right next to each other? What does it really mean? Multiplication. So what am I going to do? I'm going to find F at 3, which is going to give me a number. I'm going to find G at 3, which is going to give me another number, and then I'm going to multiply those two together. And when I multiply those two, you get negative 1. Do you guys understand what I just said? Yes? What does it mean to be F minus G of 5? What are you first going to do? Find the value of F5, right? Next one you're going to do is find the value of G5. Then you're going to subtract those two values, and you should get negative 7. Now, what happened at H? Why is there so many answers? What does it mean to be G inverse 0? You're looking for the X coordinate. Your Y coordinate you know is going to be 0. You want the X coordinates that make that true. Well, let's go up here. What happens when my Y is 0? How many times does it hit? 1, 2, 3, 4. Right? Where does it hit? So list those to me down here. Negative 3, right? Negative 3, yes?
Negative 1.
Look, negative 3, negative 1, positive 2, and 4, right? And they plugged all four of those values into the f function. That's how they got. Now, how come they only got three answers up here if I plug in four things? Because one of the answers is doubled. Do I have to put that answer down twice? No, only once. That's why I went from four to three. Because two of them use the same one. Are you following me on that? Okay, this one, I'm going to look for where the y is 3. I'm going to use that x value wherever y is 3, and I'm going to plug that right back into the f function, and if you do that, you should get 3. How are we doing on this? All right, let's move on from this section. Next section says, they give you the function. Now, what's the difference in this one? Last time they gave us a graph. This time they give us what? They give us the equations, right? So here's what's going to happen. If it says f of g of negative 2, what's the first thing I'm going to do? I'm going to take g and I'm going to put negative 2 into it. So what is the g function? It's going to be take the x out, put negative 2 in its place, use parentheses always whenever you plug in, squared plus 4. 4 plus 4 equals. So now I'm going to do f at what? 8. And then that means that it's going to be 3 times, take the x out, put an 8 in, minus 1. That's just, remember, it's 3x minus 1. This replaces the x. 24 minus 1, which is 23. How are we doing? Go ahead and try quickly b. All right, so if you plugged it in and you tried it on your own, you just got an answer of 53. Is there anyone who needs me to go over that? Okay, if you plug in negative 2 into here first, right? Negative 2 times 3 is a negative 6. Negative 6 minus 1 is negative 7. Did you get that part? All right. Then you plug the negative 7 into the x here, so that's going to become negative 7 squared plus 4. Negative 7 squared is 49. 49 plus 4 is 53. You got it? All right. We're not going to go through too many of these. But, like, if you have this, I just want to show you some things. If they ask you to plug in 2x, they don't give you a number in this case. Does that make sense? You are still taking out the x and putting whatever's in this bubble in its place. You got me. Well, what does this bubble become? Well, if I take out the x, it was g of x looks like this. This has a reference. X squared plus 4, correct? So I take the x out, and what did I put in its place? But what do I use when I do that? Now, why does that matter? Because this is why we've said plug in with parentheses. This right here is not the same thing as this. Who does the square belong to in this example? Only the x. Who does the square belong to in this one? And that's why they get 4x squared plus 4. Then they take, so this is right here. So we're right there. They then take, hey, f of x is really 3x minus 1. They take the x out, and they put this in its place. So it becomes 3 times all of that. That's what we took out, put x in it, that in its place, minus 1. That's just right there. You guys following me? Distribute. And when they distribute, they get 12x squared plus 12 minus 1. Combine like terms, and that's how they get that answer right there. Yes? All right. Same thing if they ask you just to do a, they ask you to do with just x. Remember, have we changed g of x? Did we make it a 2x or anything like we did before? No. So what is g of x? X squared plus 4. You with me? Now, what does it become down here? F of x is 3x minus 1. My x becomes x squared plus 4. You distribute the 3, 3x squared plus 12. Combine like terms, 3x squared plus 11. Yes? Right here? The only thing that's tricky on this one is when I plug in, it's x, f of x is 3x minus 1. G of x is x squared plus 4. So this now is going to go right here, and that's where they came up with this formula right there. You guys with me? What happens when we square something? What happens when we square it? Should I have to write this out? In my class, do I think that you should have to write that out? Have I taught you a pattern? Yes. You take this number and square it. 3x squared is going to be 9x squared. Everybody sees where that comes from, right? How do I get my middle term? This times this, which 3 times negative 1 is a negative 3, and double it, which is a negative 6x. Then you square the last number. Negative 1 times 1, a negative 1 is positive 1. Does everybody see where that? So I think you should go from this step to this step with no problem. I don't think you need to waste your time foiling, because I've told you this pattern over and over. You're supposed to recognize it. And then the plus 4, just combine like terms, and boom, you've got your answer. How we doing? All right. How does Jess mess this up? Well, she was a girl. Anyways, not that part. But right here, what does she take this as? She takes that as a multiplication. Is that a multiplication sign? No, it is not. It is meant to be a what? It's M of P is the way that you would say that. M of P of X. So she just multiplied them. What should she have done, which is what they're going to ask us to do next, is she should have taken this, and it should be 5 minus, take the x out, put this in its place. You with me? You with me?
Yeah.
3x squared plus x. Well, what happens with this negative? What should I do with it? So we get 5 minus 3x squared minus x. Write in standard form. Standard form, normally the highest exponents go first, and then next lowest, and then the nothing, the constants. So I just rewrote it in the standard form. You guys following me? The signs that are in front of it stay with it. So this was a negative. This was a negative. There's a positive sign in front of it, so that's why it went positive 5. And that's what they asked me to do in B. Alright, then they ask me, is P of M of X equivalent? There's a reason why, because we're going to talk about that in our next, they're kind of leading you to the next section. Is this equivalent to what we had up here? No, it's not. Alright, I'm not going to do too many more of these plugging in things, a little bit on these. We're going to talk about some of the tough spots, but I'm gonna believe that you can plug in on your own. Even if you have something up in the exponent spot, it still gets plugged in, right? So like if they said f of g of x, I'm going to take the g of x and plug it into the x spot of the f function, right? So what happens is this x now becomes an x plus 3. Just combine like terms. 3 minus 1 is 2. With me on that. Okay? Over here, the f is going to replace the x and the g function. Well, it normally looked like this, which was just x plus 3. So I took out the x, and I put this in its place. Right? Nothing too difficult about that. Now, there are some things that we needed to talk about for, like, you can do this with logs. The only thing you need to be careful of is what happens when you have 5 and log 5x. What happens with these guys? Log 5 to the log 5. What do they do to each other? Cancel out. Okay? And so it's gone. What happens right here? Well, first off, what can I do with something to a power in the log function? Bring it to the forward, correct? So then I have x minus 1 times log 5 of 5. What happens when you have the same base and the same argument? What does it really become? Because it's really, the question is 5 to the what power equals 5? So what does this really turn into? 1. Does that make sense? So it's not, it turns into 1. That's why we say it cancels out, right? So this is gone. Then I get x minus 1 plus 1. Well, what happens when I have a negative 1 and a positive 1? Turns into an x. You with me? You guys with me on this? Now, what happened here, though? What was I left with here? What was I left with here? Remember that. That's going to be something that we're going to get to in just a minute. What happens? And notice I did f of g, and then over here I did g of f. You have to do both of them. Okay? We'll talk about that in just a second. Again, here, they do it. Even with decimals, it's okay. And again, notice I got x and x left over. That's going to be something special that means something to us. Right here, when I do it, they don't get the same thing, but you can still do it with square roots. All you had to do was take this right here is going to replace my x, right? So instead of 2x squared, it's going to be 2 square root of x squared. What happens to square and square roots? They cancel out too, and you have to do absolute value of x, and this x now becomes a square root of x. You guys following what I'm talking about? Literally just take whatever's in this bubble and replace the x's with those. You'll be good. And then you have to simplify, which that can get a little hairy. All right? How are we doing so far? Good? How come, someone asked me, this is a good question, how come this square and this square root didn't cancel out? Because it's not around the entire thing. Exactly. This square only belongs to the, it has to belong to the 2, it has to belong to the x, and the x back here in order to cancel that out. All right, so here's, and we're not going to go, we're just going to get right to it. All right. What happens is it's known as the identity function. These guys are known as identity functions. If you have it to where you have them both cancel out to just x. So f of g of x all simplifies to x, and g of f of x simplifies all to x. It's called the identity function. That makes them inverses of each other. So in the next part, you see how it says, use composite functions to determine whether the given functions are inverses. If they are inverses of each other, then f of g of x and g of f of x will all equal just x. Does that make sense? So let's go through the problems. I'm not going to talk too much about how to do this, the plug-in stuff. I will a little bit on some of these. But if you want to look through it, you can go back to the video and play it. Do you see how, what does this simplify to? And what does this simplify to? What does that mean for these guys? They're inverses of each other. Does that make sense? Okay? But notice I had to do what? Both. C of D and D of C. Following me. Now, there is one tricky part right here. Look, again, what does d of x really equal? D of x is right here, 1 over x plus 6, correct? Well, what does c of x equal? 1 over x. So it became 1 over, this was x, so I put that in its place. Right here, that was an x, so it became that. Minus 6, you with me? Now, we need to stop being afraid of fractions, guys. They're not that difficult, especially with this one right here. Do we divide by fractions? So it becomes, can I write 1, that this is this one right here, can I write that as a fraction 1 over 1? Do we divide by the other fraction? What do we do instead? Multiply, and by what's this going to be over here? Correct? Top times top, it's just going to be x plus 6 over bottom times bottom is just 1, so it's just going to be an x plus 6. Does everybody see how this turned into that, which is not that scary? And then that minus 6 comes from right there. Yes? So please stop being afraid and use your rules like you're supposed to. We go ahead and They plug in the stuff, they switch out the X's, they distribute this guy right here, right? What happens when they distribute this 5/4 and this 4/5? They cancel out just X, then they distribute this and you get this nasty number right here. These guys can't combine until I make this 4 and I make that a 12. That's how they get a negative 3 left over. That should not make it. This right here is probably where I'll see most of you make your mistake, and that's middle school math.
So if you get the X, then like, if you get the X in the first one, you put up, it's like.
No, you have to do both.
So it's like, you have to save things.
Right. So these guys right here, you can tell they don't match up, so they're not going to be inverses of each other. I think they're actually, if they're inverses of each other, they are going to equal X, and it's going to equal X. So for the test, you could take it, you could do that if you wanted, but when we're doing the homework or any practice, you probably should practice just doing both of them, just have the practice going into both. D of X and X of, or whatever. C of D and D of C. All right, Maggie. Maggie goes on and she tries to do something. She tries to make a connection. She tries to go, hey, if they get the same thing at the end, then I know they're equivalent, right? Well, here's the problem with that. She plugs a 0 in for F of G of 0. She then does G of F of 0, and what happens? She gets the same thing. So Maggie goes, hey, that means that these guys must be inverses of each other. You cannot do that with math. In fact, if you are ever going to make a rule or you're going to make a statement like this always happens, you have to do it with variables. You can't do it with known values because sometimes you will get an answer that does work here, but in all the other cases it doesn't work. So watch. If we go through and we do this the right way, we realize that you get this value here and this value here, which actually, if you look at that, doesn't it look the same? Doesn't this look the same as that? Oh, this is the problem. That is the big difference. This right here, you're taking only this cube root. Where in this one, you're taking the cube root of 1 also. You see the difference there. And then watch what happens. When I do this, if you plugged in 1, for example, into both of them, you get a 9 here, and you get a 2.26. So just because it does it one time with a specific number doesn't mean it will always work. That's why we plug in, we test it by using the variables, because if you get this here and that same thing over there, you know they're going to be inverse of each other. It's going to be X. Does that make sense? So you cannot use specific examples to prove whether they're inverse of each other. You cannot use that.
So you can't use like numbers, just like
right.
Just variables.
Right. Because I can make up silly rules like, well, it's the one I always go to. Oh, 2 plus 2 is what?
4.
And 2 times 2 is what? If you multiply the same number or you add the same number, you always get the same answer. Right? I use a specific example to make a rule. And then the person goes, 3 plus 3 is 6. And 3 times 3 is 9. Boom. False. As soon as you can come up with one counterexample in math, that is not a rule. For it to be a rule, it has to work every single time. So for this question, they're asking us to come up with, they're giving us the composite, okay? They want us to come up with the H and the K that when you plugged in, you're going to plug in the A or the K into the H that it would give you this out. So if you notice, what they did is they make H just the square root of X. And they make the K 7X minus 5. so that when I replace this x with that, this x with that, it becomes the square root of 7x minus 5. Do you follow what they did? Okay? Same thing over here. They made this. You want this to be 11x minus 9 plus 3. So what they did is, if I make the h 11x plus 3, then what can I do is I can make this my x, and then I have x. Is this the only answer, by the way? Could I make this that wouldn't be a very good example. What else can we do? I mean, technically, it could go x. No, it wouldn't work. I don't know how they're saying it would vary. It's the only one I can think of. Because you have to replace the x with that. What about this one? Could we do this? Could we do square root of x minus 5? Could that be our h? You with me? And then what could k be? What could the k of x be? Just 7x. You with me? And then you take the 7x, would replace that, and that would become that total when you composite them. You following me? So I can see how this one varies a little bit. All right. So then we need to finish. We're going to talk about this domain. I'm going to, again, record this video, and I'll put it up on YouTube for you guys to finish it tonight. Okay? All right. So for domain restrictions, we're going to look at AX. And we know that underneath the denominator, I'm not allowed to have a negative. So what they do is you realize that it has to be greater than negative 3. So that's going to be the domain of the first one. And since it's allowed to be negative 3, they put a bracket symbol there. So negative 3 is included, and it goes all the way to infinity. They put a parenthesis symbol because this is not included. Infinity is not a number, it's a concept, so we can't include it. This one right here, how far does this thing go to the left? It goes forever to the left. How far does it go to the right? It goes forever to the right. So it goes from negative infinity to positive infinity. Whereas this one, you can see it stops going left, and it stops going left right here at negative 3. So that's the smallest x could be. They write the composite, and they go through, they substitute stuff in, and then if you look right here, and you try to make your domain, you're going to be like, well, x can be anything. But if you go back in the problem, you have a square root right here. And you realize that that's going to restrict what my x can be. I know that I can't put anything in that's going to kick out a negative under a square root. So that's why it has to be greater than a negative 3 still. Now for this one, when they go ahead and give me the composite of this guy, right here, I know that my square root has to be greater than 0. Underneath my square root has to be, it's not allowed to be negative. So that means that underneath there has to be greater than 0. So x squared minus 1 has to be greater than 0. Add 1, and you get x squared is greater than or equal to 1. You square root both sides, square root. You get x has to be greater than 1 or equal to. And then when you do the opposite, which is negative 1, you have to flip that sign over. So that's where they get this domain from. And if you look at the graph that they gave us, that makes sense. They're saying it's here or this way. Any values down here are going, in between here and here, are going to kick out imaginary numbers because you got a negative under a square root. Alright, so when we go and do the domain, sometimes you got to look through the problem and see if there's anything that restricts it. So if you look through here, there's no restrictions that happen. So it's going to be from negative infinity to positive infinity. But as you go to this problem right here, we've got something under a square root. So right here, we know we're going to have restrictions. So you say x squared minus 4, it's got to be greater than 0 or equal to, because you're allowed to have a zero underneath there. So I add 4, and I get x squared is greater than or equal to 4 square root. Square root, plus or minus sign's coming, but it's got to be greater than or equal to 4. Since I'm going to put the negative 4, I've got to switch that sign. Square root of 4 is 2. So that's where they get this domain from. All right, when they go to do this one, again, you got to look through and see in any of these sections if there is a restriction. Right here, we have something in the denominator. We know that the denominator is not allowed to be 0. So I want to go, when does 4x minus 1, when does it equal 0? I'm going to add 1. 4x equals 1 divided by 4 divided by 4. X equals 1/4. So I don't understand. This is, domain is okay. You could also say something about all reals. Except x is not allowed to equal 1/4. That's basically what they're saying right here. When they say x has to be greater than 1/4, or x has less than 1/4, or greater than 1/4. So x can basically be any number except for 1/4, because it's not allowed to be equal. All right, in this one, the final answer looks like there's no restrictions. But if I look back up here, I see I have something underneath the square root. So I want to go, when does x plus 1, and that together has to be greater than or equal to 0. And so I subtract 1, I realize that x has to be greater than or equal to negative 1. And that's where they get this domain from, because that right there gives me a restriction. Sometimes you have to look back before the answer to see if there's any restrictions. And right here you're actually going to have a couple times where you have restrictions. You look up here, right here you have a denominator. So I know that x is not allowed to be negative 2, because if it's negative 2, it makes that denominator 0. And then right here, I'm going to look, and I've got another thing in the denominator. So I go, when does 2x plus 5, when does that equal 0? Minus 5, minus 5. 2x equals negative 5 divided by 2, divided by 2. X equals negative 5 halves. And so that's why they say it's all real numbers except for those two values, because that would make this denominator 0, and this would make this denominator 0. All right, last problem. The number of bacteria in the refrigerated food is given by this equation, where C is the temperature of the food in Celsius. So if I know the temperature, I can tell you how much bacteria. Now, when the food is removed from the refrigeration, the temperature of the food is given by this. So if I give you the temperature, or if I give you the time it was removed, you can find the temperature. If I give you the temperature, you can find how much bacteria. So that's how that's a composite function. And so what happens is, they say in 30 minutes. Now the only problem with this one is, time is supposed to be in hours. 30 minutes is really 0.5 hours, so when they plug in, that's why you see this 0.5. What they do is they plug in 0.5 into this. 0.5 times 4 is 2. 2 plus 2 is 4. That's where they get B at 4. They then take the 4 and plug it into all these spots right here. 4 squared. They simplify and then get 500. There's 500 bacteria on that food after it's been removed for 30 minutes. All right? After 2 hours from refrigeration. Well, 2 hours, now the 2 is actually in hours, so I can just plug it in. 4 times 2 is 8, plus 2 is 10. Now my C value is going to become 10, so they just plug it in, simplify, and you see that there's 1,700 bacteria now after 2 hours. Refrigerated food has been removed long enough to reach a temperature of 14 degrees is considered unsafe. So in this question, they gave me the degrees, which was Celsius. Remember, C at T equals 4T plus 2. And so this time they gave us this value, and they want us to figure out how much time it would take to get to 14 degrees. So they plugged in the 14, they minus 2 from both sides, they divide by 4 from both sides, and they get, after 3 hours, it would reach a temperature of 14 degrees Celsius, which would be considered unsafe to eat. So determine the domain for this would mean that where's the safe spot? It's from 0 hours. Time has to be greater than that because we can't go back in time to eat something. And it can go up to 3 hours to get to that. Now write a function to determine. Now all they want me to do is they want me to write this bacteria equation instead of using the Celsius, instead of using C as a variable, they want me to write it using time. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to replace everything in the B function, I'm going to replace all my C's with what it is in T value, which is C 4T plus 2. So let me go back. B of C of T, you're going to say C of T is really 4T plus 2. You're going to replace all the C's with 4T plus 2 and then simplify. We've already talked about in the class when you square something. I know that this is squared is 16T squared. This times this is 8T times 2 is 16T. And this squared is 4. So that's where they got all that. They distribute the 20. That's where they get all this. They distribute the 80. That's where they get this and this. Then they combine like terms to get this as my final equation. We know the domain is 0, 2, 3. We just talked about that. And now they said determine the range. The range is going to be the y values. So I want to start at the smallest x, which is going to be 0. So they plugged in 0. And they see that the smallest amount of bacteria on even a refrigerated food, there's 420 bacteria. If you take and you go to the highest x, which is after 3 hours, you plug in and solve, and you realize there's 3,300. All right? When will the number of bacteria reach 2,000? We just use our equation, and we put the known value of 2,000 over here, and we're going to solve for how much time it would take to get to that. So the first thing we do is minus 420. That's where they get this value. Divide by 320 on both sides, divide by 300, that's where they get this number. Square root both sides, square root, and technically the answer should be plus or minus 2.222 repeating, but we can't use the negative, it doesn't make sense for our, we can't go back in time. So 2.2 is the only logical answer. All right, and that'll be good.